G'day and welcome again to the Campfire Project panel discussion. And this is a big one because today is our 80th panel discussion. So we've been doing quite well along the way. And with me today, I have first of all, Adrian Hanks, who is a life mastery wizard. How are you, Adrian?
I'm really good, Alan. Thank you. Great to see that fire burning behind you, mate.
Keeping us all warm. It's really great. Then we have Clint Adams, who's a former police officer and rehabilitation counsellor. How are you, Clint?
Yeah, I'm great too. Thanks, Alan. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. And we have Marc, Nuss, who is a partnership manager for Destiny Rescue. G'day, Marc.
G'day, mate. Thanks so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
I've been waiting to get the three of you together because I know that you've all worked with children, and we thought today was a great time to talk about exposing and stopping the plight of children being used for sex. And I know in today's age, we're getting more and more of that all the time. And with the lockdowns, we've got domestic violence and all sorts of abuses actually on the rise. So, Adrian, when we were talking the other day, you posed the idea of talking about this subject. So would you like to kick us off?
Yeah, I will, Adam. Look, what a topic. It's not an easy topic to broach, but it's an essential topic, I believe, because particularly with the lockdowns happening now, the rise of abuse around children is rising. Even the Australian government have just put more money into the internet security because they said the increase has just increased, particularly online, with the pedophilia rings in Australia. So it's a huge topic. My own personal journey around this is when I was in South Africa, I did my psychotherapy training on a village orphanage. And many of those children on the orphanage had been abused sexually by predominantly men, and it was pretty horrific way to be introduced to my third year of psychotherapy and counseling, was actually working with some of these traumatized children and seeing the negative effects of what it did to those children. Some of the horror stories that I heard in some of the counseling sessions was horrific. And it just made me more aware of what was actually happening, not just in South Africa, but across the planet. So I've been following that. I've actually worked a fair bit with families in my counseling space around family trauma, around children being sexually abused. It's a huge topic, Alan. And my heart goes out to families that have to deal with this. Mm-hmm. And let's hope that we can bring more awareness, you know, tonight and today through this campfire meeting to bring more awareness around this so we can actually stop this purge on the plight of these children.
That's exactly right. And Marc, you would have had you've been on the ground with Destiny Rescue and out in a lot of those villages and Asian countries where you've been trying to rescue the children from that situation. So I'd like to share a little bit yourself.
Yes, so just for those that maybe have not heard, I'll just give you a quick intro. Destiny Rescue was started here in Southeast Queensland over 18 years ago, and we're involved in seven, now eight countries mostly across Southeast Asia, and then Dominican Republic, which is outside of Southeast Asia. And we go in undercover, act like we're sex tourists. I've been involved in that. And we go into brothels, bars, and karaoke bars, and all these hellholes you can think of, and even dark and dingy places. And we look for children that are being trafficked. And then once we find them, we rescue them out of that, and we take them through our rescue centers where they get trauma counsel and so forth. And the thing, Ellen, is that this we can see a real increase in this, and as well as a lot of other NGOs out there, we're expecting a tsunami wave of more children going to be trafficked into this, because a lot of that causes this is poverty. And also at the moment, also a lot of this is amazing how criminal elements can adapt. So with COVID, you think everything's shut down, and so the sex tourism is kind of halted, can't stop, but all of these crime rings, all they've done is they just moved everything online. And so we actually as an organization had to hurriedly kind of adapt and kind of start our own cyber division, if I can put it that way, to actually focus on this area and try and, and kind of keep up with where the demand is going so that we can still be out there rescuing children. And if you don't mind, I'll just kind of launch in one of our first cyber rescue, if I can bring that in, was was a two-year-old boy that we rescued in the Philippines. And what happened is in England, the police there raided a suspect's house and found on his phone this pornographic material where this two-year-old boy was being abused. And so, and this is this tragedy of it, is now these days you've got different, a lot of this also driven by pornographic websites out there. And they'll pay, you know, children's caregivers, their parents, they'll pay them basically $40 for them abusing online a child. And then that material's then sold through all of these platforms. And so, the police got hold of that video, and so they could see it was from in the Philippines, but they couldn't see where. So they contacted the National Bureau of Investigation in the Philippines, and they that's a police organization in the Philippines department, especially that deals with these type of cases and child trafficking. And they contacted us because we work in partnership with these agencies. And so, long story short, as we infiltrated this website that this the perpetrators were using, and acted as if we were a pedophile, and then got the information, and it was a slow process, but then kind of worked out where this child or child was being abused, and then got in contact with his father-in-law that was abusing, his stepfather that was abusing him. And the stepfather, we got in contact with him and made as if we were a pedophile that wants to fly in and come and physically abuse the child. And in long story short is we set up this thing with the National Bureau of Investigation, including the English police unit that was dealing with this, and we set up a sting in a hotel, and the stepdad came and handed over his two-year-old son to basically a stranger, our guy acting as if he's a purchaser, and we handed out money and then got possession of the child as to take the child to a hotel room to go and abuse him, and that's when the NBI jumped in and took the guy into custody. And we created basically a human wall between him and the child, and both him and his wife are now in jail. And I'm happy to say the two-year-old boy went through safe custody with us, and then obviously is going through a process of trauma counsel and so forth. But that was just the tip, getting into that area. Now it's grown so quickly for us. So we've already had so many raids right now because it's not only these, but they also use social media platforms, and so we've had to infiltrate those to see where they're taking these children and how they're trafficking them. So I think it's guesstimated that about 10 million children have been trafficked at the moment. We believe it will be much more higher because that's actually physical trafficking, never mind stuff that's online. And a large percentage of that is for sex trafficking. So it's a huge, huge problem. But you know what? You know, I'm just so honored to be in company of these wonderful gentlemen that you've got today on the panel, because it takes everybody taking a stance people talking about it. And like, thanks so much, Alan, for opening this up, because the more we talk about it, the more we shine light on this, the more people will start asking the right questions.
That's it.
So thank you so much.
Yeah. And when you said that the physical stuff where they were traveling before, and with COVID locking that down, you thought, you know, people would think that would be reduced. But we found the same thing with bullying in the playground. When they stopped the kids bullying in the playground, cyberspace bullying went through the roof because they were able to hide much easier. Because physically, if it's in the schoolyard, they're going to be seen by somebody. So very careful about what they do. But over the internet, they're not being seen and they can hide in the shadows.
That's
I'm not
exactly
surprised
it.
That it's gone up dramatically. Clint, in your work and that, you would have come across a lot of this with in the police force as well, wouldn't you?
Yeah, probably nowhere near as bad as where Mark's gone. I mean, I've been involved with, going into houses where, you know, kids have been abused physically and not necessarily raped or sexually, but, you know, physical abuse. And there's certainly some high profile cases that get around about, you know, kids being periodically just or long-term kind of suffering under, you know, being abused by domestic violence kind of stuff and that kind of thing. And look, certainly, you know, rape in general's, you know, always been around and always been obviously an issue and that kind of stuff. So yeah, I've had a fair bit of exposure around that. Had to take a lot of kids away from parents as a police officer and go into houses, and a big part of even the work that I've kind of done through the book that I've come up with, which is more around building around someone's committed suicide, is in that space. And you touched on it before, Marc, around having the discussions, more people having the discussions and making the undiscussable discussable. A big part of, you know, bullying and all that kind of stuff and having mental health problems in general is partly because, you know, people go inside and then they go underground. They don't want to talk about it for a number of different reasons, cultural ones, you know, gender ones and all that kind of stuff. And this is another topic where it's about, I guess, getting people to have the discussion, because something's stopping that discussion from happening. If a child's, you know, if they're really young, and certainly ones that I've had some kind of contact with, when they're really young, they obviously don't understand what's going on, especially sexual abuse. A two-year-old certainly can't articulate any of that stuff. So there's that part. But, you know, as they get a little bit older, they know something's not right, but they don't feel comfortable. Or if they do go talk to somebody, they don't listen, or they're not taking it in. Kids don't make this stuff up, right? So you know, just even that kind of awareness and having people take more note where something's not right. My gut feeling's telling me, why is a three-year-old or a five-year-old or whatever, you know, talking about stuff like this when it's family members and that kind of stuff, is important. But also understanding, I use something called the dialogue model, which comes from a book called Crucial Conversations and How to Have Them, if you've ever come across it. I know I sent it to Alan a few weeks ago. I use that a lot, and I probably come from a work sense more, and then I work my way back to, you know, I'm working with adults, but they've all been kids, just like we've been kids at some point. And then you look at why don't we talk about stuff, and, you know, what's the right environment. And a big part of not talking about it is, if I don't feel safe about the conversation, for whatever reason, you're going to laugh at me, or I think you're going to laugh at me, or you're going to have some negative impact on what I'm about to say, is a big part of holding those conversations back, including this topic where, you know, there's been talk, certainly, and being from South Africa myself, you know, obviously a darker skin South Africa in the apartheid days, you know, there's lots of things that were happening, you know, domestic violence, people verbally abusing. I've certainly been around that. As a child, I had some issues with some sexual abuse as a child, and, you know, not to the extreme end, but certainly things that still stick in your mind as a much older person that I am now. And, you know, I guess you could say I got lucky. It didn't kind of go where it could have gone and that kind of stuff. But, you know, you kind of deal with it. And then you look at your, I never really spoke to anybody about it until I was married. And you know, I don't think it affects me. It's certainly not in that sense. And but at the same time, you know, there's lots of other things that were also helping me and supporting me. I had a very supportive family. Parents were fine. No, none of those kinds of issues. So I guess it wasn't all bad. And so I probably could have gone down a different path as a child having that experience. But look, I think a key part is how we make it discussable. And like having these discussions where we're going first and we're creating safety. So when we think about conversations in general, it's about creating that safety where, I certainly, when I'm working with people on how we get to the root discussion and the stuff that we need to, is about going, okay, well, how do I help create the safety for that environment? And part of these kinds of discussions is doing that, where we're talking about stuff that maybe other people go, ooh, I don't really want to hear the story. Cause I watched your one-on-one earlier today, Marc, so I heard the story that you just covered again. And, you know, yeah, like no one wants to hear that. They go, I'm not, you know, I've done so it myself. True. I've done this myself as a cop when I was still in the police force. I'm coming home and then, you know, my wife would say, oh, this happened to someone, and it's horrible stuff. And you kind of go, I've heard enough of this stuff in my own work life. I don't want to hear any more about it. But, you know, you kind of need to talk about it, and you need to have that. And it's not about a safety issue for me. It's just like, sometimes you don't want to hear the negativity. So you think, oh, look, just sticking my head in the sand is going to make things better. And that's not necessarily kind of the case.
Yeah, because one of the things that I thought of was the fact that, you know, some people, you know, people won't talk about this stuff, but they'll watch movies with rapes and, you know, kids getting abused and things like that. I'm the other way around. I cannot watch those movies, but I feel that this is a subject we need to talk about, no matter how hard it is to talk about it, because if we don't, nothing changes.
Yeah.
So somebody's got to step up and, you know, get into the dirt, so to speak. You know, take the action and that, so that we change it.
Yeah.
Never will watch movies got rape in it. I just turn it off and walk away. If it's got children being abused, cannot stand that at all because it just makes me angry. And so I just take that anger and go, okay, let's have these conversations about the real life situations and change them.
Yeah.
Yes, definitely.
Agree.
And yeah. And if I could just throw, Clint, I totally agree with you. I've had people that I come across and you want to talk, and I've had actually people physically say, I don't want to hear it, I don't want to hear it, and just walked away.
Hmm.
Where for me, I understand if people have gone through trauma themselves, you know, and I think it's very important to be able to have a platform or any way to be able to talk about these things, because probably Clint, you were kind of hinting at that. I had something happened to me when I was a child, not my parents, but it was wrong place, just young child, got moved aside with a girl by adult. And anyway, I don't have to go into those details, but those things are traumatic and it affects the gut. And so first thing I know, and the thing is, a lot of children and even adults, a lot of times they can't even talk about it. Like for me, I didn't go to my parents and said, this happened to me. No, I held it in, and I probably only kind of mentioned to them later on when, like you said, you got married and, you know, so for me, we've got to create the platforms and the way of the safety that people can actually talk about it. Because the more you can, the sooner you can talk about a traumatic event, the more you open up, allow healing to be able to come into play and allow those things to be, because we form then certain thought processes in our mind and nearly, I want to say, strongholds in our mind, where because of the trauma forces us to start acting a certain way and start believing in a certain way. And sometimes those things need to be broken down. And we find with our, you know, to take it directly with our girls and then, you know, also boys, is that when we take them, we've got to first take them through a type of trauma counseling process, and it's not one size fits all. You can't say this strategy, okay, we'll use this strategy and that's going to work. No, because we're all individuals. We've all got our own unique makeup, and certain people, it affects certain people differently in different ways. And so the whole thing about also creating that space was, you know, when we deal with these children with trauma counselors, to give them different ways how to start actually opening up and start actually expressing what's inside of them, expressing the hurt and also all these areas. And, you know, some of them got actual physical hurts and that we could have given medical help, but each one is on their own journey in different way. And with that, you could use so many different avenues to kind of reach that child, whether it's through art, whether it's through all of these different matters, how they can start expressing what's actually inside of them. So I think for, you know, like what we're talking about now, is the more people are getting educated about this, more they can actually talk to their own family members and their friends and so forth, and give them the safe spaces where they can actually start opening up and talking about it.
If I may jump in there, Mark, a lot of the work I do, if I have clients, adult clients who have been abused as a child, taking on that role that somehow it was their fault, and that's a huge one for adults to work with in psychotherapy, is they're abused as a child, and something in their mind says there must be something wrong with me, it was my fault. Mm. So adults go through life, you know, people go through life believing that the trauma that they went through is actually their fault. They carry, you know, not just the guilt and the shame, but this idea that there must be something incredibly wrong with them because of the situation. And that's life liberating for so many people. Mm-hmm. And it's really common. Child abuse, say it again, child abuse is really, really common. Mm-hmm. In most families, there is an incident of child abuse.
Mm. One level or another.
It's quite incredible. And the most common, you know, perpetrators of that are immediate family members, you know, parents, uncles, aunties, cousins, a huge, and it's quite often, it is somebody that the child knows that they have trust in.
Mm.
And this is why often they don't come forward, because of the trust factor within the family, because they're supposedly, you know, have love and trust for this, for the perpetrators of this horrific crime. It's pretty horrific.
And just on that too, like if it isn't resolved at that early stage, or you know, they've held onto it and they obviously become adults and that kind of stuff, they have a different idea of sexuality, a different idea if it's obviously sexual abuse. They have a different way of dealing with issues, like if it's a domestic violence ones, which I used to see more of than obviously Mark's been involved with. you see those common patterns go through, and then they bring it on, and their way of dealing with it is kind of a misguided version. So it's, you know, they're kind of doomed to a certain point because they don't, they can't change it. No one's a good role model around them. So they don't talk to anybody. They don't, the ones that tend to come out the other end, and this is those positive deviants, if you want to put a term to it, where, you know, something happens in between where they've come across somebody who either takes them under their wing and turns their lives around. And when they have those discussion points, I've got a friend who her name's Dr. Daly Watson, and she runs this thing called Open Parachute, where they're interviewing young people that are coming out of lots of different things that have happened to them, but they're talking about what they did to change or who was impacting on them and how that's helped them through. And so, again, that conversation, I know you talked about this too, Adrian, in your one-on-one, you know, having conversations and feeling comfortable with people and having the right role models. I know you were talking about males, but obviously it works for both, you know, as well. But, you know, just getting the right people at the right time, talking about the right things, and if they feel comfortable enough to then go, you know what, and also it's about educating parents. Like, I'm running a session later this month with a school, with a sports team. They've got about 300 young, I say young people, they're about 13 to 18. They had a suicide earlier this year, and this is about mental health. And the big part of what I spoke to the president, who's talking to me, was saying, well, he's like, you know, how do we identify when kids are struggling? How do I identify this? And for me, it was more around saying, it's not, they know when they're in pain. They know this stuff. So what we've got to try and work on, as well as obviously if you see something's not right, you have a conversation, but it's about saying, how do we get them to the point where they feel comfortable that they can go to mum and dad? Just because, you know, dad's the big bravado kind of classic guy from our era, because we all look roughly similar ages, and you know, heading towards the 50 mark and or more. So, you know,
I love it.
I think the more was you,
come
Alan.
Back again. You can definitely come back again.
The more was you, Alan.
Thanks.
Yeah, he already told us that, so that's okay. He's given us the safety to have that conversation. It's not going to hurt. But you know, my point, I guess, for this guy, I was like, we got to do more to talk to the parents and have them at these sessions when I run this, around them understanding that they've got to create that safety for the kid to say, no matter what it is, no matter how bad it is, we've got your back. And you can talk to me about anything. If you're in trouble, we'll deal with it. If you, you know, and I think that's a big part of the two-pronged attack. You know, yes, we can try and identify stuff, but some people hide this very well. Okay, when they're kids, it's probably a little bit less, but, you know, oh, he's a quiet person. He goes to his room. We don't see him for hours and hours and days and days. So is he hot? You know, that kind of stuff. So it's a combination of the two things. For me, it's always about how do we create the safety? What are we doing? Are you actually... Because, you know, me as a parent myself, I've got a 25-year-old and a 23-year-old, and I've, you know, my daughter came to us in her teens where she was being bullied at school, and, you know, she was at the point where she said, look, she thought about it. She hadn't actually done anything around suicide, and then it was a big eye-opener for me, because you don't want to get that wrong. You don't want to make that. You know, you can only muck it up once, and then it's life-changing for everybody. So for us, we made a big decision, and we end up moving. You know, not everyone has that opportunity to just go and do that stuff. But, you know, these are, you know, especially when you're talking kids, they don't know any different. And, okay, she was a teen, but you're talking younger people, and there's teens as well who are obviously still going through this stuff. So it's about bringing it out of it and putting that spotlight on it and just talking about these bigger issues. But then also really, I think part of it is also getting governments, agencies and that to understand that that's also work that needs to be done. Yes, it's all great to go in and, you know, extract kids out of there. And I'm sure there's, and I know that you have done a lot of preventative stuff too. And, you know, I think more needs to be done in that space, because obviously prevention is so much better than cure, as we all agree.
Totally.
Yeah. So I think, look, I mean, for me, like even just listening to your one-on-ones today, and I've seen some movies on this stuff, and I've got, when I worked with the asylum seekers in Nauru and Manus Island over here, I came into contact with a lot of army guys, worked in SAS, and they go in and do kind of similar things where bad things are happening. And, you know, it doesn't always end well physically for certain perpetrators as well. You know, they're probably maybe a bit more heavy-handed than your organisation, but you know, it certainly opens your eyes to what's happening in the world, and putting our head in the sand just not going to change anything. So,
a lot of things need to be addressed, and it's a case of, well, it's breaking it down into components. It's like, first of all, understanding why they have so much shame around this, why they feel that they're the one who has the problem, understanding how that came about, which quite often is a perpetrator who instills that in them, that they then believe that they're the one who is at fault. But being at the front end to stop the flow of that happening in the first place. So that's one area we need to be. We need to be at the other end where they're coming out the other side, and we need to be able to connect with them and help them to understand that, hey, this is not about them. It's not about their lack of anything. It was about the perpetrator who did it to them. There shouldn't be any shame or anything around what they've been through, and helping them to actually talk to people and find the right people for them. But we need that to be right across the board, where all the different agencies are on the same page, because I've been involved in a lot of groups where charity groups where we've looked at all these charities and then realized that none of them knew about each other in a lot of cases, and they were doing the same type of work. But because they were own organizations, they weren't, even when they did find out about each other, they weren't talking to each other. So they were effective in their own little area, but ineffective in what they could do together. And some of them were working against each other in the way in which they operated. So to anybody who went through one and went through the next one, would have had confusion of what was going on.
Look, it is coming to a head. There's a lot of more awareness around what's going on. There's a lot of people now in the Hollywood industry speaking out. There's you know, if you want to go and Google some of the producers and workers in Hollywood, some of the film stars now coming out and actually talking about some of their experiences and actually naming people in Hollywood are involved in this you know, child industry, and it's really starting, the spotlight is being shined. A lot of the countries in the world, you know, they've been protecting the perpetrators, you know, some of the high-end clients in that space, you know, people with, you know, lots of money, lots of positions, you know, politicians and doctors and people in the higher echelons of society have been protected for a long time, and that's slowly crumbling, thankfully, you know, and the protection is slowly slipping away. I mean, Marc could probably share a bit on that as well from his experience, but just from what I've researched and looked at, thankfully there are people now coming out and speaking the truth about what's happening, and lots more children are being rescued. There's lots of organizations now doing that. You know, Donald Trump has, you know, put in, you know, several $1 million in child protection. The Australian government, as I mentioned earlier, are putting in money for child protection. So it's starting to become aware. And my sense is what happened with domestic violence, you know, sort of 5 or 6 years ago, when it just came to a head, the same thing is happening now around child abuse. It's sort of the latest focus, and about time.
Like, how do we push that to a head sooner than later? And the fact that, you know, those people who were in positions of power, a lot of money, who were getting away with it all the time, and then people started speaking up. So is it the fact that we have power comes from not so much just those that have the money, but the number of other people who on the other side decide, right, this is enough, we need to start talking and getting together? So it becomes a, not just something where everybody whinges about what's happening, but gets together to say, right, we need to stop this and take some positive action in getting it to stop.
And a lot of it, Alan, is because social media now has got the focus on it, because, you know, 90% of the planet now get their information from the internet, from social media. And because in the last probably 12 months, it's just become the focus on social media, it has brought more awareness, and more, of course, when there's awareness, more can be done. And I think that's, you know, the benefit of social media is it can put the spotlight on things like family domestic violence or pedophilia and other things that go to the child sex industry. So thank you know, God for social media in that realm. It's got its negatives, but in this realm, it's actually a positive. Sliding over to that more and more.
Because, you know, making sure that, you know, what we're seeing is what we're really seeing, and not just something that we're feeling. and making sure that that's right. Because social media is just a tool. It's neither good nor bad. Yeah. It's the people who use it. And that's what it comes down to. And we noticed with COVID, with everybody going online, people were starting to communicate more than they were when they were in. Now, you walk through Sydney and there's, what, how many million people walk past you in a day? Yeah. And none of them talk to each other. As soon as we had COVID, there were less people on the street. Everyone was smiling at each other and, you know, talking, saying hello as they were going past each other. Yeah. So social media can be exactly the same thing. It's been quite abusive with people taking sides and fighting over things and fighting over stuff they didn't even know anything about. But they just assumed because of some condition that they had or some agenda they've got. So it's making sure that, yes, if we do make that stand, we've got some controls into it, make sure that we're not creating another problem at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
At the same time, not holding back on this, but moving forward with it.
Yes.
I think the thing is,
sorry, go, Mark.
The thing is, we can see, like for us at DCRC, we can see changes happening where before in the early days when we started, I mean, you try and organize a raid to, because we all do COVID rescues where we go one-on-one and rescue the children one by one out, and then we do raid rescues because we want to see these places closed down and the perpetrators go to jail who are running these operations. But if there wasn't the, you know, like early days, like I said, we've been doing it over 18 years, just like you try and organize a raid and then somebody would go and tip off the owners and suddenly the children would just disappear and it would all look squeaky clean on the day of the raid and stuff like that. But you know, those were kind of the bad seeds. So there were some real good, but what a lot of these governments did is they started creating their own, these specialist police departments who would actually want to see the changes. And then what's happened also in the meantime is that, like we've gone, example, the US. The US gives a lot of grants to a lot of countries out there, but they went and tied their grants to how are those countries dealing with human trafficking. And so basically they made it like, okay, if you're doing everything you can in your power, if you put money into it, they can see that you are really fighting human trafficking, you get like 100% of the funds that was going to come. But if they're saying, okay, you're doing some work, you know, it goes down until the point where if they see you basically just turning a blind eye as a government, not doing anything, you get zip, nada. Hmm. And we've seen on ground how that's affected governments to start wanting to see changes. Hmm. And that's how we were started seeing. That opened the door more for us, where before we were trying to, you know, nearly pleading with, you know, different departments, you know, help us to help you. Hmm. Now we've built up these amazing relationships because it came from the top down. And I think the more we talk about this, more we have, you know, platforms like yours, Alan, more people actually start expressing their viewpoints and saying, this is not okay. This is, you know, start talking about, Clint, when you're talking about suicide and creating a safe environment for children and for young adults and even adults to be able to openly talk about it. Like suicide, you know, like the Black Dog Foundation, all of these things are coming more and more to the forefront because more and more people decided, you know what, we're going to start talking about it. Mm-hmm. And so I'm a fan of like this podcast and any other platforms where we can actually start talking about these openly about it. Because the more we do it, the more we educate people, the more people will raise that up into their point where they say, you know what, enough's enough. We're not standing for this anymore. Mm. And so.
Yeah, so one of the things is you were saying, Clint, that quite often we may not see it in the person themselves because, you know, they've gone quiet or whatever, and we may not be able to recognize it. Well, I think we can recognize a lot when you know how to profile people properly.
Sure.
You can see the behaviors and things. But for most people, that's a skill that they don't have. So is there any tips that we can give to people? Because we can talk about how bad it is all day long, mm-hmm. but we've got to be able to give some ideas to people on what they can do. Because every person out there who's got a good heart, and especially if they're listening to this, they're going, well, what can I do to make a difference?
Yeah, so, I keep going back to...
What things can they look for?
I keep going back to the dialogue model. And the reason for it is it's around... you know, the conversations. We can deal with a lot of things if people are having the right conversations. And the thing I love about the dialogue model is two dialogues that's going on. One is happening in my head and in the person that's with me or whoever else is around having the conversation. And then there's the actual dialogue that we have together. And I guess if something's in my head that's saying, I don't want to talk about this, I've got a fear factor for it. And it's generally a fear. So we either go defensive or aggressive, the old fight or flight natural instinct. And you see it flow through it in the work environment where, you know, when I don't know if you've heard of human synergistics, but I won't go into the details too much if you haven't. But in human synergistics, they do 360 degree feedback for managers in organizations all around the world. And they give you this profile. And essentially, the profile looks like this. They have three colors, blue, red, and green. And essentially, the red is the highly aggressive person. The green is the highly defensive person. Both defense mechanisms, that's fight or flight again. And then blue is kind of, it's all based around Maslow's hierarchy of needs. But you see the patterns that show you that the best managers and, you know, and the best organizations or the top 10 and the bottom 10, the dominant factors are obviously those red and greens for the worst and then the blue for the best. And it's the same with adults. And then it also goes down to the individual person too, that they usually get better outcomes in their lives if they are more in the blue and they're less highly aggressive or highly defensive. And I'm talking about the extremes here. And so same with kids. If they have anything that's that trauma that follows them through their early lives, they end up being these adults. And so if they have that dominant side to being highly aggressive or highly defensive, the conversations they have are usually that way. They're usually that, you know, you talk to someone and they just bite your head off and you go, whoa, where did that come from? And that's kind of what you see as a symptom of how they communicate. Or the defensive person will just say nothing and back down when they're even feeling any kind of fear. So they go highly defensive. And so they never deal with their problems. They never have those discussions with people at the levels that they should have because they never had people do that. So the one piece of advice for me is more around as a parent, for example, obviously we're talking about kids today. So as a parent, you know, what am I doing to help my child feel that they can do that? And I should show them some of that. I need to learn some of those skills myself so that I bring it out of them, interacting with them, teaching them. And I know the stuff in your stuff you were talking, your one-on-one, Adrian, around men and, you know, learning from good role models and all that kind of stuff. They're the people that have that impact on you because they mightn't know the model, but they do these things. And, you know, you also talked about it before when we talk about there's many ways to the top of this mountain. Like for me, when I was doing counseling, what I really found was how no matter what those things are that work for me and doesn't work for someone else, they all have a similar outcome, which is about getting me to change focus. So you talk about art before and talking about, you know, an expression of some other way. What I found when I found things were more effective is if I don't wallow in what's happening with me, and when you're in defense mode, that's that fight or flight. Defense mode is all about me, or about me, what's around me, what's in my headspace. But if I start to focus on something else, whatever that something else is, whether it's art, whether it's playing with a puppy, you know, it's not about me. It's kind of something else. Like they're putting their focus. So it all goes around that focus and what wires and fires together in the neurons, in the brains. I go back into the neurospace where, you know, sometimes you don't have to understand all that, but you kind of know lots of things are effective. That's why lots of different psychology methodologies all have an impact. They're all effective to a reason, but they all tend to have that focus, getting you to change on something else, talk about it, deal with it, rather than focus on where you are now, what's wrong, what's not great, and all that kind of stuff. So for me, you know, I guess understanding a bit more about that stuff and really as a parent, focusing on how you talk to your kids, what I say, like me saying, oh, suck it up, princess, to my son when he's feeling bad or he's crying, is going to do what? Well, one, I'm putting a fear factor in there where it's like, this is not okay. I'm saying that to him. He's taking that in. I mightn't mean it that way. It's like, you know, I don't want my son to be a wussy or whatever word we want to use for it, but it has an impact and it has him thinking in the future. Oh, so now, next time he's not feeling like that, here comes dad. Oh, I better not cry. I won't talk to him about it because he's just going to go down this path. So there's that safety for that conversation is gone. And you can blow that safety really, really quickly as a parent or even as an adult. You know, I used to see it at work where people would be horrified getting called in. Why weren't you at work? And, you know, the manager's having a crack at them. And then, on the side because they feel comfortable talking to me because I create a bit of a safety with them because I know them and they know me. And they say, you know, I've had mental health problems. It's not something I want to talk to people about. I'm uncomfortable with this. I'm a 50-year-old man and I don't want people knowing my stuff because they give me shit at work. Or sorry, I shouldn't swear. You know, they're giving me stuff at work that's you know, negative. So there's a safety for that. The stigma is attached to that and no one wants to be known as that person. So you wonder why this stuff goes underground. That's where I think, you know, we need to do, me personally, and the way I've written my book is more around helping kids at that earlier age when it isn't a pattern yet. Like I'm dealing with people at work level where they, you know, in their 50s and 40s, and they've got a massive pattern on this stuff. Whereas if you're dealing with a 4 or 5 year old and the teachers, you know, there's no established relationships with the new kids. There's no, oh, what brand are you wearing? And they don't really do that comparison thing yet. We could be dealing with this stuff a lot earlier and creating earlier resilience, earlier getting used to having the conversation, feeling comfortable that, oh, I don't feel comfortable having with this, but I'll still have it because it's structured. The teacher's there. There's a little bit of safety. Again, if the teachers don't understand that safety, but also understand what's happening in the kid's head when they're thinking, and oh, you're looking a bit worried there, Clint, why aren't you talking, and coaxing it out, so saying, it's okay, we can talk in this environment. Little Johnny over there just talked about what's, and it's a calibration of behavior too, where what's acceptable, what's not acceptable, and it becomes, you know, you're role modeling good behavior, and you're role modeling what you're not willing to accept. If we whack every person for doing the wrong thing at that level daily, it starts to go, hang on, no, this is not acceptable. You're not going to be a bully because we're not accepting bullying behavior. We understand that you're not a bad kid. We're here to, and so, you know, it's kind of, I guess, helping with that stuff as well, where I think that a lot of that stuff's missing.
Because when we look at young children, you know, if you ask them to describe somebody, one of the funniest things is that quite often color doesn't get even mentioned.
No.
And so racism is a learnt behavior, but it's, you know, the stuff that we hear, and it can be a throwaway line and it takes an impact. You know, I've had times in, you know, back in a few years back where I had things going on and I'd say to myself, oh, suck it up, buttercup. And I'm saying it to myself and I'm going, well, God, have I ever said that to anybody else? And by the way, where did I hear that in the first place? Where did that come from to me to throw that at myself?
Yeah.
So I don't need someone to beat me up. I was too busy beating myself up.
Yes.
And so how do we, you know, as you say, get to the kids younger, help them to understand that, you know, they are fine on their own. There's nothing wrong with them and everything else. But teaching them before they go through those things, but it gets pretty hard when it's happening to kids that are 2 years old. Getting to them that early.
A couple of things I'd share on that, Alan, is one is, for those people, you know, got children, I don't have any young children anymore, I've got grandchildren now, but just watch the children. And if there's any change in the children, take it seriously, like, you know, get them checked. It's better to be wrong and sorry rather than do nothing and be sorry.
Yeah.
Really is. And the other thing I'd share, and maybe, you know, so Marc doesn't have to push this as much, so it's not like a sell for him, but I'd suggest, sometimes leaving it to the experts is a really good thing to do. And one way we can support it is through our wallets, through our pockets, and supporting organizations like Rescue, Destiny Rescue, and orphanages like, you know, Bocciabello in Africa, where that I support. And just giving a few dollars can make all the difference, particularly if it's in places like Indonesia, where a dollar goes a long way, or Africa. It can make a huge difference. And imagine, you know, the idea that $10 or $5 is going to bring a child out of the sex slave industry into an education. I mean, just that thought alone for me is that $5 or $10 or $20 well spent. So there are a couple of things. One is, you know, take it seriously. And the other is, you know, maybe you can do a little bit more from the financial perspective, leaving it to the experts who are working to support those children.
And that's really important too. As you said, if you're sitting in a cafe having a cup of coffee with somebody and you're buying the coffee, just think of those two coffees and that together could be that $10 that's doing some change, doing some difference. Yes, leave it to the experts. We need to be aware, and if we see something going on, instead of taking our action and causing problems, go along and talk to the experts and say, hey, this is what I saw. Am I reading this right? And that way you're taking action, but you're not causing a problem and having somebody misjudge because you think you've got it right and you got it wrong.
Mm.
Then go and talk to the experts. And in that way, the experts get more recognition of what they're doing, which therefore gets more government funding and things like that. We can then get more money coming into those as well. So again, it's another We Together project where if we all get together and do that, we're going to get a better result.
Yep. Yeah, I think that's a key point around the expert side. Like I look back on my career when I was working as a counsellor, and I look at my work that I've been doing as a HR professional in change management and all that stuff. And I guess I got to a point where I was looking at the leverage of this is not enough. Like, you know, there was a high profile. I was writing my book. It took 6 years to write because a lot of, I guess, neuroscience stuff and a lot of other stuff that goes with writing this kind of book. And I got to a point where it was a lot of work. I was working full time doing all this stuff. But then you know, something just kicked in, and the young girl Dolly, who died now nearly 2 or 3 years ago, who was part of the Akubra ads, you might have seen it in the news here in Australia. And it kind of just went, you know, young 13, 14 year olds should not be killing themselves, you know, you know, temporary issues and that kind of stuff. And so I kind of had a moment where I was like, well, how do I leverage this? So I wouldn't call myself an expert, but I think I'm very good at connecting high academic stuff with making it practical for the person on the ground. And when I look at it from a HR perspective, it's kind of that. And I've always had that ability to connect with the person on the ground. And it doesn't matter what levels are, you kind of just have to make it practical, make it work. And this was no different. And so your point around the experts, I think, you know, the experts, even if they're not the experts, it's about getting people to think about, well, what other stuff can we do? What other stuff can we come up with? And so when I even wrote my book, it was about just putting that notion into people's minds. And in the book, I'm a character in the book, helping the school deal with the suicide, helping the school deal with their leadership stuff, which is what I first apparently came in for as part of the story. And it's about making it, you know, I guess resonate with people and make them ask some questions and then go, okay, well, you know, just because I'm a student, because part of what I do in the book is get the students thinking about, well, what solutions have you got? Don't come to me. I'm not the font of all knowledge. You're students, you're smart. What do you think you can do? You might come up with things that are different to me as a, you know, old bugger like I am. You think differently. You can use social media better. You can do this, you can do that. And so, I guess it's about also what, you know, what can we as more experienced people say, well, how do we leverage this young talent? How do we leverage the teachers? How do we leverage other resources? Because I see you've all been there. We've seen all these programs in a number of different things that the government have come up with. I remember a few years ago, you know, there was an Aboriginal and Julie Gillard ended up scrapping it because they were spending all this money and they had nothing to show for it because, it probably wasn't targeted the right people. The people running them didn't understand enough about Indigenous people. I've been working with some people in Mount Isa around the, you know, where the Indigenous people are at, and understanding just their whole makeup. They're not an Aboriginal nation. They're all these multi different tribes, and they have totally different kind of ways of thinking, and you know, they don't agree with each other and all that. People have this view, you're an Aboriginal, then you're an Aboriginal. That's just not the case. So, you know, there's a lot of stuff out there where I just think, you know, we can leverage off the right ways, and that's kind of the focus on, well, how do we do that? What do we come up with? Let's start, you know, put think tanks together or whatever that is, or what that looks like is a key part of it. And stuff like this is important where, you know, you're interacting with people that you may not necessarily interact with, which is, I thank you for putting this together, Alan. And yes, watching the one-on-ones is interesting too, because, you know, I'll probably go back and look at some of the other ones you've done now, because you introduced me to these two guys and then you go, oh yeah, and I can kind of relate to a lot of the stuff, not all of it. Some of it I've had some exposure to, and we've all had different experiences, but when you kind of, it makes you think differently by talking to people that have done different things too, which I love.
It means we can come together and have bigger discussions with all those people as well. But as you mentioned about the youth, back when my boys, this is what, 20 years ago now, or best part of, actually over 20 years, my boys, older two, were at high school. There was a father, his daughter had been raped by some of the boys at one of the schools. And his mate said, instead of getting angry, why don't you get in and, you know, make some changes? And what he did, he started a group called Fathers Against Rape. And he was going around all the high schools and getting the fathers of boys to turn up. And we were originally told that we would go into the room with our sons, but the way they broke it up, and from the, well, it was Newcastle High School, there were only two fathers, me and another guy who went in. None of the other fathers went. But when we went into the room, we were put in the room with not our own sons, but other other boys from the, you know, from the same year. And they ran a scenario where they'd ask the boys a question, and the answers on the first response, it was like, where in the world do you get these rubbish ideas from? But then they ran it like a hypothetical. If that's the case, then what about this? Within that 40-minute period, because they worked it into a class period, within that 40 minutes, these boys went from these idiots who had no knowledge of anything to what I thought was over 6 foot tall young men who had reasoned the answers out themselves. And they came to the solution and they went up and they took ownership of it.
Oh.
Which is what we try and do in coaching, get people to take ownership of where they are, and so they become their own healer of their process.
Yeah.
So these boys were doing that. So I think that is a great area to get back involved in with the youth, because if the youth are going through that and you've got the kids that are in their later teens that have been through it younger, to have them input into it and feel that they are part of this and they can make a difference, that's part of their healing. But it's also getting the other youths of the same age looking at it as well and going, hey, this stuff does go on. It hasn't happened to me, but I understand. And therefore they can empathize and connect with the ones that have been through it and start a new front. And therefore, as they get older, there's less of those people who will be perpetrators of this as well.
Mm-hmm. And so, that whole bystander effect where, you know, people see it happening, and because they have a little bit of fear for that, oh, they're not doing it to me, I'm okay, and just putting your head down. And that's why if you're having those conversations earlier and the teachers are creating that environment where it's okay to talk up, hang on, we had this discussion yesterday and we agreed that wasn't going to be the go. So I feel comfortable, and I know that person's got my back because they were talking about it when we had this conversation. So you kind of, I'm not saying you're building courage, but you're kind of building their ability to understand, I'm uncomfortable, but I can still do something. And so, you know, you're inching your way there rather than going from here to here. You're put up with it for years and years, which is what happens. And then there's a big blow up. Someone's suddenly courageous, but it ends really badly for them because they've now just gone boom.
Yeah.
You know, and that's kind of, I guess, and to your point, Alan, in the book, I've really tried to emphasize the coaching approach where I'm talking to the students and doing that interaction. I'm going, I'm not giving you all the solutions. Go and ask yourself some questions and go and have a look. You come up with some stuff, you guys talk amongst each other, and then you come back. And so, you know, yeah, I kind of subtly putting that in the book as the character who's running stuff like I would as a coach, but not actively saying, you know, these are the 12 steps you should follow to get to the top of the mountain.
You're making them part of the solution to their own solution to the problem. As opposed to giving them the solutions and expecting them to administer it. If they've worked through it, then they own it. They understand it. They've worked it out and they know that it can work.
Yeah.
We give them to them. How the hell do they know whether it works until they try? But because they haven't tried before, they're right down at the tail end with no confidence to apply it.
Yeah.
Like asking them to start in kindergarten and jump straight to university.
Yeah.
We've got to take them through a process where they learn and build new skills along the way.
And they also they think differently. Like, you know, me as a 13-year-old and compare a 13-year-old living in this era, you know, totally different. You know, things, my I call them my nieces, they're my cousins' kids, but I call them my nieces. You know, they're primary school kids. And the stuff they can do on the iPads and the computers, here's me. I think I'm tech savvy, but clearly not, you know, but amazing just how quick they pick things up. And, you know, there's great experiments out there, which is awesome, but I won't bore you with some of that. But yeah, I think, you know, their thinking's different. And that's what I like about the stuff Dr. Hayley Watson's doing with her open parachute and the school-based programs, just getting people listening to other kids that have come through it. They're still in their teens. They're still at high school and they, you know, they've got some great insights. Some are different and may not be relevant to individuals at the time, but there's enough of these videos and it's raw. you know, they've had the emotion, they've had the experience, and they talk about it. And again, it makes someone else go, oh, to your point, you know, oh, that happened to me, or it may have happened, or I felt like that, but I didn't go down a path, but I heard about this, you know. And so again, anything that's bringing that conversation piece closer and better is going to help.
Yeah, because that experience, it comes back to learning styles. It's problem-based learning and experiential learning. And we know that when we use that, we learn how to think. Whereas instead of the way that we teach at the moment is rote learning, which would be if we just talked at them and said, you look for this, you do this, etc. Well, how much of the stuff did you learn at school after you finished your final exam and went out the door? How long did you remember any of that? Okay. It's usually forgotten pretty quickly. Yep. So by not being the preacher at them, but getting them involved where they work through this, they create the answers. And they take ownership of that, and that will then be lasting well into their right through their life. Stuff that they won't forget.
Agree.
Yes, and I can just say I think that's part of our thing with our success rate with that. Once the girls go through our programs, that why they don't, we've got a very high percentage that never fall back into getting themselves in that vulnerable position. And part of that is with going through trauma counsel, everything is we get them, all we can do is give them the tools to be able to open up, and then show them that they are not, this is not the end. They're not the, yes, they're a victim, but that's not their identity.
Mm.
And then show them, no, but your identity is way more than this. You're an overcomer, and show them a glimpse of what the future can be like. And then it's amazing. And then we give them the where they've got to choose which direction they want to go to. Because you've taken somebody that's been a victim, which they've been forced into something that they have no choice about. They were forced into something. Now you get them whole, but you get them to a point where now you choose. And that's why we call this the risk, is they choose their own destiny. And I feel that's part of our success rate, is because we don't pigeonhole them all and say, okay, you all got to go this way or this direction or this vocation. We have kids that went all multiple, you know, some have become nurses and some have become digital animators and you name it. Because at the end of the day, we leave them with the choice. What is it that you want to do? So our job is just give them the tools to see themselves not anymore as a victim, but to see them as little overcomers and say, all right, now, what are you going to do with it? What direction you want to go with your life?
Mm.
And that's the most amazing thing to see, is that you've got these children that have gone through all of this trauma, but we're able to, in the end, is to see them just pick, this is the direction I want to go into, and then see them run with it. This is probably the most satisfying thing of all of it. And I just totally agree with what's been said so far, is that you've got to give them the tools where they've got to make the decision themselves. Because you can't hold their hand, and even for us as an organization, you can't hold their hand all the way through. You've got to, at some stage, be able to let them go. All you can do is give them the tools so that they can then make those decisions for themselves.
Yeah.
When I look at all this, I see everything as connected. Now, we might talk about domestic violence, might talk about any particular area, but I see everything as connected. And if these children find, as they go up from young children into youth and everything else, and they learn these skills, then they become a more aware adult. And as they become more aware adults, it means that they're going to behave differently to a lot of the adults today, which means that domestic violence is automatically going to be reduced very quickly, simply because they're not going to be susceptible to that. And if they do that, then the impact they have on their children, then we have an even more advanced generation coming through after them, if I could use that word. And so we are making a change all the way through all the cycles. We're not just working on one little problem. That problem is connected to everything else. Mm-hmm. And so that's one of the reasons why I think this is a really important subject. And one that I'll do a live after this goes up as well. I'm going to put the challenge out to everybody else who's done a one-on-one. Well, first of all, those who haven't done a one-on-one, but have an area of expertise or knowledge in this area, do a one-on-one with me. All those that have done a one-on-one, let's get some more of these discussions going and mix the panels up so that we get more and more people talking about it and more people connecting. And in that, I know that, Adrian and Marc, you had first sort of built a connection between the two of you. And then when you heard Clint talking, you think, right, we need to bring Clint in as well. And so having those connections, and so that the community right across the board gets stronger. And if we're working in that area and bringing our expertise in, we'll make some major changes. Mark.
And also, we it's us as human beings should always be learning. We should always be growing and learning. And so for me, even out of this, you know, just even hearing you, Clint, talk, and I'm already mentally making some notes myself. I'm going, wait a minute, all right. I've learned something out of this. And so I think I love this concept of bringing different people from, we're all from different spheres of life and different things. And I even like the intersection, Clint, here, you and I talking, you know, and we're from the same country. But when we grew up, we were segregated as individuals, you know, and we grew up in the same area. And yep. It just shows me the amazing, I just found it fantastic, how we can be together now and be able to talk. And I think our backgrounds, even for me, and Clint, you came from one side of it, I came from the other side, but I think it enriches our conversation as one goes on, because you learn out of your mistakes, you learn out of the things that don't work, and we as human beings should always continually be learning. So yeah. I think this is a fantastic way of doing it.
Yeah,
and thanks so much, Alan.
Yeah, and there's a beautiful proverb, maybe as a good way to complete, is it takes a village to raise a child.
Yes, totally.
And here we have an international village of men and women. Yes. You know.
I'm going to ask each of you for your permission. What I've done in the past is, you know, one-on-ones never go outside the Campfire Project. We always advertise and get people to come in because some of the talks have been raw. And I don't look at shades of grey until you know where black and white is, so I just leave it black and white. The panel discussions, we had been taking the audios out, and they have been going up on my personal podcast, but I'm now putting together a Campfire Project one, which will have those panel discussions, the audios going up. But what I usually do is put these in the Campfire Project and advertise them outside. What I'd like to do with this one, with your permission, is to put it straight outside and say, right, this is what we're doing in the Campfire Project. One, to raise greater awareness to a larger number of people outside. And secondly, to get people to go, is this what they do in the Campfire Project? It gets more people coming in. Mm-hmm. Because what we've found with the Campfire Project so far is that the respect that the men and women have been paying each other has been absolutely magnificent. And, you know, I haven't had a panel discussion yet. And as I said, this is number 80. I've done 79 of them. Angela popped in and did one number 79, I think it was, so she beat me, but I got 80. And so with that, with getting more people coming in and more discussions into here, so with your permission, I'll put this one outside.
All good with me.
All good.
Excellent.
All good.
So before we finish off, is there anything that each of you would like to leave the listeners with?
I'd just like to say, look, if anyone, you know, obviously we've heard each other speak and obviously seen each other's one-on-ones, I'm more than happy if people want to ask questions outside of this. I've got you both on LinkedIn. I think I sent one out to you today, Marc, and Adrian, you've accepted today. So just hook up with me, give me a call. We can have a chat outside.
Yes, definitely.
I think there's definitely some common things that we can help each other with. And at the end of the day, it's about, you know, I guess creating a better life out there for people and give some better insight. And, you know, I think we've all got things that we can definitely help each other with, but more than happy for you to look me up there and we have a chat outside of that as well.
Excellent. Yeah. Fantastic. Yeah. No, I'm all good, Alan. I think I've said enough and there's lots more to say, but that's another panel, I think.
Yep.
Excellent.
Yeah. Thanks, Alan.
I'll leave everybody with is, remember in the Campfire Project, you got the video section on the side, but you've also got the file section. And there is a number of PDFs because we've been doing some education in here as well, but there are two in particular. One is the panel discussions, which are in chronological order. So they're in date order, 1 through to 80, which will be the next one going in. The other file is the one-on-ones. And in there, you'll find that they're in, not in date order, but in alphabetical order as per the person's first name. Once you find that, you'll see their picture, but you'll also find the link to the videos. So anybody, you guys, you know, you've already done, Clint, but the people who are listening into this outside, if you want to know more about these three men and you want to know more about the others, jump into there, go through. There's over 160-something one-on-ones we've had in there so far. So you've got the best part of 130, 140 hours of viewing there. And then with the panel discussions, I don't think we've had any that have been less than an hour. So there's another 80 hours there. So there's plenty of viewing. to where you can go in and find answers for yourself, solutions to situations you might have, but also find out more about the people that are on these panels and then know that you can connect with them. Because you guys have all said today, and everybody, other panel I've had, you're open to have people get contact you on that, because
yes,
the heart of everybody who's on the panels are giving all the time. So yes, I have to thank the three of you for being part of the Campfire Project and part of my life as well. So I appreciate it.
Thanks. Thank you, Al, for organising.
Thanks, Alan. Thanks, Adrian.
Thanks, everybody else. We'll see you on the next panel discussion. Yeah. Bye for now.
Thanks, guys. Have a good one.